Week number three. We talk a lot about the church downtown, or the downtown church, which is the New Life in Christ Church, or NLICC. New Life in Christ Church has become very special to us, and us to them. They serve a very low income area and provide not only their members, but the surrounding area with Christian love and caring. We have supported them with keeping the food pantry supplied as they prepare meals for Wednesday Bible study, snack for kids, activities before and after school, and Thanksgiving dinner. We have filled their clothes closet with warm jackets and clothing, and we have supported a scholarship program for deserving young people. This COVID year, when their activities were put on hold, EBCC did not put our support on hold. With a few changes, we have been there for them. Instead of food pantry and snacks, we came through with generous gifts of food gift cards. Some cards helped them prepare takeout meals for families in need, and some went directly to the families to purchase much needed food. We provided gift cards and monetary gifts, providing Thanksgiving meals for 25 plus families. At Christmas, our generous support helped provide gifts for their Christmas store, where church families could shop for donated gifts and provide a happy Christmas for their families. We also provided special monetary gift for 7 families in desperate financial need to cover rent and medical situations. Our hearts are always with the New Life in Christ Church family. Today we have a special guest. Pastor Mike Duran from the New Life in Christ Church is a seminary student, assistant pastor to Jack LaPietra, an all-round busy guy. He's here today with his wife and little child. We will all enjoy his love and enthusiasm for the Lord.
All right, this next hymn was chosen for Missions Month. The name of the song is Others. I know we've done it in the past, but it may be unfamiliar to you. So let's give it a try. Sing a song called Spirit of the Sovereign Lord. It's by Andy Park, and it was written in 1994. I had never heard this one before, but it fits so perfectly with the scripture that Mike has brought us from Isaiah 61 that I couldn't resist. So it's a pretty easy chorus. I think you'll pick it up pretty quickly. So let's sing it together. Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news. The Spirit of the Sovereign God is upon you, because he has anointed you to preach good news.
Hello, hello, hello. Hope everybody's doing okay. My name is Michael Duran. I know some of you may remember me from the times I've came and preached in the past. Some of you who have never met me, I hope to meet you one day in person, but I am a pastor at New Life in Christ, one of your partner churches. You guys have supported us in tremendous ways, and I just want to thank you from me and from the staff and from every member of our congregation. Just want to thank you with all our hearts for what you have done. You guys have provided us with tremendous blessings, and you continue to always support us when we need your help during the holidays, and just being part of the same family in Christ. We are just grateful and thankful to you. So, I was actually asked to give this message. I'll be giving it in person on Sunday morning. but for those who aren't able to get out of their homes at the time, at this moment or at this time, I'm glad that I'm able to come into your home and bless you by delivering this message to you via internet. Just a little bit about myself. I am just been named, one of the lead pastors at New Life in Christ. So you can imagine that I have a lot on my plate. I actually just became a father a year ago. My son actually just turned one on the 19th. So we're just have our hands full and actually going to school still to get my associates. I mean, God is just continuously improving and, pruning me, just helping me become a better servant of His. And I just pray by me being available that He continues to help me grow. And one of the ways He's helping me grow is by preaching, even when it's a new format. I have actually never preached this way. I normally use slides in my sermons, but I've never done it to a computer screen. But I know I'm not doing it to a computer screen. I'm doing it to you guys, and I'm also doing it unto the Lord. So I'm pretty excited and hope this turns out pretty good. Before I even start, because you can hear it in my voice that I'm a little nervous, if we could just pray so that way I could get my nerves calm, and then that way we could just get in the right mindset, for hearing what God wants to speak to us. So if you guys are at home, if you could close your eyes and bow your heads and open your hearts and pray in agreement with me, I would greatly appreciate it. Father God, Lord of heaven and earth, we are here today, Lord, to just give you all praise and glory. Lord, let me stay out of your way and use me in any way you see fit. Speak through me, Lord, for we are here to hear what you have to say, Lord. Lord, we love you. We thank you and pray this all in your name, Jesus. And we all said, amen. So again, I'm just thankful to deliver this message. The message I'm going to deliver today, I titled it, This Favor. This favor that I want to talk about is the favor the Lord has given us. We're going to talk about His favor. His favor that He has just bestowed upon us. He continues to bless us all the time. If we woke up today, that was a blessing. But it even gets deeper than that. We are undeserving of the favor He has shown us, and yet He still gives it to us, right? We never deserved grace or mercy, but He gave it to us anyway. He loved us enough to come and pay our debt. He came to show us who He was in Jesus Christ and through the scriptures. And I just wanted to talk about how awesome this is. And by doing so, hopefully we could walk away from this message just being revitalized and just remember that, even though we are going through a lot and there's a lot of things that we could probably do without, there's a lot of things that He is giving us that we just need to start to be more aware of. We got to start counting the little blessings that He bestows upon us every morning and every day. So if you guys know anything about New Life in Christ, we get our mission statement from Luke 4:19, and because we believe it's up to us to proclaim the good news to the poor and to lift up the oppressed. So it's one of our mission statements is when Jesus came to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, He started His ministry off by reading this in the synagogue in Galilee, where in Luke 4:18-19, it says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for He has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come." So by Jesus coming, the first time, because he's going to come a second time. But Jesus coming the first time, he came to proclaim the Lord's favor. It was the time that everybody was able to see God's favor in the flesh, right? They would have looked at Christ and known that God still loves them, that he loves them enough to be there when they need him most. And we need him most when things are going bad, but we also need him most when things are going good. We just need him all the time. You know, that's why we, like it says in Psalms 30, we sing to the Lord. All you godly ones praise his holy name, for his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may last through the night, but joy comes with the morning. We sing to the Lord. We are just so grateful and joyous to him. And it's, if we know who the Lord is, we are always going to praise his holy name. And one of the main reasons that we get to have this mentality, or we get to have this condition of praise in our hearts, is that we know that we may fall short, or we will fall short. We have fallen short, right? You know, but yet God, just like any courageous father, or, you know, like any loving parent would, mother or father, they got to correct those children of theirs, right? You know, that they got to make sure that their kids are doing the right thing. And if we're doing the wrong thing, you know, he's going to rebuke us. He's going to make sure that we learn our lesson and don't do it. But his favor is always going to still be upon us. You know, like a father who corrects his son does it out of love. He doesn't do it just to be mean, but he does it because he knows once he does that, his son is going to be better off for it, or his daughter. Or, you know, if his mother corrects the son or the daughter, she knows she's doing it because she loves them. It's not because they just want to be a killjoy, but they want to actually teach him something. And so what ends up happening is God, you know, is always going to show us his favor. And he even shows us his favor through the times that he has put on us, which seem like tough, because, you know, we're going to have tough times. But in the time of my favor, the Lord says, I will answer you, and in the day of salvation, I will help you. So we're going to have tough times and we're going to have hard times, but he's saying in that time, he still will have his favor, right? We will still be able to go to him, and we'll be able to go to him without fear. You know, of course we fear the Lord because, you know, he's the Lord, but we don't fear him in a way that the rest of the world fears him, where we don't understand, or we're not able to go to him. We fear him because we know we don't want to disappoint him, right? We fear breaking his heart, but we are able to go to him even after we get in trouble, or even after we do something wrong, and ask him for help. You know, we may do something that gets us landed in jail, or having to pay a fine, or, you know, we made a decision that was just not so good, and now we're suffering the consequences. God didn't turn away from us. He allowed us to suffer those consequences because, you know, we need to learn from the mistakes we made, but we are still able to go to him and ask him for help. And it says he'll answer us and he will help us. And if we are to open our eyes to these facts, then we will realize that if we look around us, we are surrounded by God's favor. We have God's favor just put in our lives daily, right? I mean, every day is a blessing from the Lord, and we should know that, and we should live that. We should live that way. Like, we should exhort the Lord because of his willingness to show us his favor, his willingness to give us his mercies and his grace. So, like, I wanted to just talk about God's favor, because I think sometimes we lose sight of the fact that we're surrounded by God's favor. You know, like we are constantly being blessed. I mean, if you were just to pause for a moment and really think about it, how many times has the Lord blessed you today? You know, how many times has He came alongside you and He's showing you favor? You know, there's simple little favors, you know, like people will be like, oh, I got front row parking today at Target. Thank you, Lord. You know what I mean? Like those are little things. Or, oh man, it must be a great day. You know, like, oh, I had a really good breakfast. You know, there's little favors that we thank the Lord for, but there's even bigger favors that we don't even take into account. Like the fact that we got running water. You know what I mean? We got water that we can just walk to the sink and get a nice clean drink of water. Or heck, right now, there's places in the nation where they don't have like heat. You know, they don't have power. The power grid is shut down. And we're over here having power in our house, you know, heat, and electricity, and we forget to just how amazing that actually is. That, like, you know, we are able to be blessed in such a way. So we're going to actually be, because we're talking about Luke chapter 4, but, you know, the passage that Jesus was reading was actually from Isaiah. The scroll he had in his hands was Isaiah, and he opened it up, went to chapter 61. Back then, they actually weren't in chapters, but, you know, we like them to have chapters and verses, so we're able to find them a lot more easier. But, you know, he had the scroll opened up to these verses, which I'm about to read. And I hope that by reading these things, we could just get a better notion of what it really is to see God's favor in our lives. So in chapter 61 of Isaiah, starting in verse 1, it says, "He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound. He has sent me to announce the year of Jubilee, the season of the Eternal's favor. For our enemy, it will be a day of God's wrath. For those who mourn, it will be a time of comfort." So before we move on, some of you probably know what Jubilee means or what the year of Jubilee is. But for those who don't, there's a little definition for you. The year of Jubilee, historically at the Jubilee, all of the debts were canceled, all of the slaves were set free, and all of the land was returned to its rightful owner. This is a physical example of the spiritual truths that were fulfilled in Jesus Christ and will be finished at His second coming. The debt of sin is canceled, the slaves of sin are set free, and the rulership of the earth will return to Jesus Christ and His bride forever. So we see the year of Jubilee as a time of freedom, and that debts will be paid. I don't know about you guys, but I've suffered through many of debt, right? And, you know, something I'm not proud of, but it was a mercy by the government that I was able to ask for bankruptcy, right? I filed bankruptcy, that was years ago. That was actually one of the things that I did before I got married, because I didn't handle my finances very well as a young man. And, you know, I wanted to get married and I didn't want to have to bring my debt over to my wife. I mean, I still had to bring some, but, you know, I was able to be forgiven a lot of it. And it was a great mercy, you know, and I was humbled by it. You know, now I want to do my best not to get back into that situation ever again. But we see the year Jubilee representing that in ancient Israel times as a similar type of thing, where things were forgiven in such a way. But in the spiritual aspect, when the second coming of Jesus Christ comes, we are going to see that all things are going to be His, right? Every knee will bow and proclaim Him as Lord. And it's saying before that time, we are still able to go to Him and ask Him to to forgive us. And if you go to him and make him Lord of your life and repent of your sins and receive his forgiveness, that debt that you owe because of your sin is forgiven. He wipes away the debt. He gives you freedom from the prison of sin. I mean, we are bounded by this life of sin before we are able to come to the Lord and receive freedom. Now we have freedom in Christ. So when we think of the year of Jubilee, I mean, wow. But you know, he did say that those who don't receive him are going to end up seeing it as a horrible and terrifying day. But those who are his are going to have nothing but joy. They're going to be comforted. Going to verse 3 of chapter 61, it says, to all who mourn, he will give beauty for ashes, joy instead of mourning, praise instead of despair. For the Lord has planted them like strong and graceful oaks for his own glory. So who did he do this for? I mean, he did it for himself, but we are recipients of the reward, right? He did it for his glory, but he did it in a way that it benefits all of us. Because without him coming and forgive paying our debt, we would never be able to make that payment, you know. I know this in Jeremiah. It says in chapter 17, verse 7 through 8, it says, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He is like a tree planted by water that sends out its roots by the stream and is not anxious in the year of drought. So it's saying, because we know who the Lord is, we could trust in him. And because we could trust in what he is doing, we could be like a tree who is able to just stand strong no matter what's going on. Even though that there may be a drought, the tree is able to withstand that drought because he digs his roots deep. And that's what we need to do when we get into a relationship with Christ. We need to dig our roots deep into the truth of who God is and trust all in who he is. And when we do this, we will receive his favor, right? And not only will we receive his favor as individuals, but like our neighborhoods, our cities, our states, our nations, you know what I mean? They'll be recipients of it too. But it all starts with the individual making that first choice. Here in Isaiah 61:4 it says, and they shall rebuild the old ruins, they shall raise up the former desolations, and they shall repair the ruined cities, the desolations of many generations. Foreigners will stand and tend your flocks, and the sons of the stranger will be your plowmen and your vineyard workers, and you will be called priests of Hashem, ministers of our God. Will be said of you, you will eat of the wealth of nations and will pride yourself in their glory. Like this in Isaiah 61:7, I use the message because it's because you got a double dose of trouble and more than you share of contempt, your inheritance in the land will be doubled and your joy will go on forever. It's kind of funny. I was watching this video. It was the video, I think it was the Bible animated series that's on YouTube. But it's pretty cool, you know, like goes through like this comic Bible that I like, and it was about Job. I was watching it with my son. I mean, he's little, so I don't know if he really like understands it, but you know, I like watching it with him, and they're talking about, you know, all the things that Job had to go through, you know, and Job, even though he went through all those things, still maintained that God was good. You know, he always, like, no matter who was telling him to, you know, his wife even told him, you know, just curse God and die. Like, I mean, this is, nobody should have to go through this, and yet here you are going through it. And what did he do? He still gave praise to the Lord. He still glorified the Lord, you know, and that's what it is, because he knows he had favor from God, and he had tremendous favor from God. And what did he do? He thanked the Lord for that favor. But then when it seemed like the favor was lifted off of him because all these bad things were going on, he still knew that he ultimately still was in God's favor because God still was with him. He still was alive. He still had life in his, he still had breath in his chest, right? He still had a heartbeat. He still was alive. And he knew that, like, he was only alive because God allowed it, you know? So he was able to just, you know, stand with the Lord. And, you know, he ended up getting his blessings doubled. You know, I'm not saying that, like, you have to get your blessings doubled if you go through trouble, because, you know, that's not going to happen every time. But, you know, it's just saying that, like, the inheritance that you will get, you know, from God is going to be tremendous. You know, like, sometimes we lose friends or even family when we come to the Lord. They stop wanting to talk to us. They stop wanting to be around us. But all of a sudden, we get new brothers and sisters in Christ, and they want to be around us, and they want to hang out with us. You know what I mean? That's just a small example, but we end up getting other friends and true friends. You know, not saying that the other friends weren't true, but, you know, they would have stuck by you. And now you got friends that know what it is to stick by, because they have a Lord, like you have a Lord, who's always stuck by us, who stays sticking by us, right? So, because of this fact, we are blessed, right? We are tremendously blessed. This is another idea of, like, if we have God's favor, we are blessed by God to have his favor. And so I was looking at Psalm 41, 1 through 3, and it says, blessed or happy, fortunate, to be envied is he who considers the weak and the poor, and the Lord will deliver him in the time of evil and trouble. The Lord will protect him and keep him alive. He shall be called blessed in the land, and you will not deliver him to the will of his enemies. The Lord will sustain, refresh, and strengthen him on his bed of languishing. All his bed you, O Lord, will turn, change, and transform in his illness. So it's like one of those things is, even in those times that we are struggling, you know, because we're struggling doesn't mean that, like, God's mad at us or that he's, like, not showing his favor. It just means that that's what's happening. It is the human condition. The human condition is that we live in a fallen, broken world, and that we will suffer at times. We will have hardships. We will get sick sometimes. You know, like, we live in a world that is constantly just falling apart, right? It's degrading the world from the moment where it was built and it was perfect and wondrous in every way. Since that moment, it has been going the other way. You know, it's been going downhill ever since, I guess, you know, along with humanity because of sin. But, you know, even so, we have this obligation or this way that we could show the rest of the world that we are not of this world. We're in this world. We're not of this world. We are of the kingdom of heaven. And, you know, we still don't look at these. We don't look at the world the same way. We would rather, instead of complain about what's going on, we would rather try to help those who are less fortunate than us and bless them. You know, if they're poor, hungry, we want to be able to feed them and take care of them. Because they're saying, well, if you are willing to bless those when they are sick and when they are in need, guess what's going to happen when you are sick and you're in need? You're going to end up getting blessed. You're going to end up getting taken care of, you know, because the Lord's going to take care of you. And that way he takes care of you might actually be through those, the same way you took care of others who were in the same condition that you may find yourself in. And that is just super amazing how God is able to do those kind of things and reveal the fact that that's what happens. You know, like, we've all heard no good deed goes unpunished, right? And that kind of discourages you. But I'm going to tell you, this good deeds are payment enough. You know what I mean? You don't do a good deed to get anything out of it. You know what? We're even blessed more if our good deed is punished, because God says, well, if you are punished for doing that good deed and you're doing it for me, believe me, I'm gonna give you a double reward, right? I'm gonna give you a double inheritance, is what he was saying. And then moving on to verse 61:8, it says, "For I, the Lord, love justice and hate robbery and wrongdoing. I will faithfully reward my people for their suffering and make an everlasting covenant with them." There he goes. He's saying, when you guys think things are unfair, if they truly are unfair, you know, don't blame God, because God is a lover of justice. You know, he hates wrongdoing. He hates when people are getting robbed for what's going on. But, you know, he is always going to faithfully reward his people. And if you are suffering because
hey, can I talk now?
Glorifying him, you know, he has an everlasting covenant with us, and he's going to take care of us. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3 to 4, it says, "Blessed, gratefully praised and adored be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforts and encourages us in every trouble, so that we will be able to comfort and encourage those who are in any kind of trouble with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God." What are we saying is, like, look at, we know what it's like to receive mercy from God. We know what it's like to receive comfort from God. So we could go to those who need comforted and who need encouragement and give it to them, because we get that from the Lord and from our brothers and sisters in Christ. And since we are receivers or recipients of comfort and encouragement from the Lord, we could also be reciprocated, right? We could give it. We could also dish it out to those who are in need of it. And God says he loves that when we do that. He loves us being able to go out there and, you know, represent him in a way where we show his love on display and care enough to help these people out. But it says as we help them out, we are being helped, because it's God's economy. That's just how it always works. In Isaiah 61:9, to the next verse, it says, "Then their offspring will be known among the nations, and their descendants in the midst of the peoples. All who see them will recognize them, because they are the offspring whom the Lord has blessed." So what's going to happen if we live in this way that I'm talking about is, they're going to know who we are. And who are we? We are Christ's children. We are the church. We are his bride. They're going to know that we are the offspring of our Father in heaven, right? We're going to be children of God. We're going to actually go and be in the world, but the world will see us and recognize us as belonging to the Lord. That's the idea, is when people see you, we hope that they see Christ. And when they see us, we hope that they see God in us, not who we are or what we're about, but who God is and what he's about. And by doing that, that keeps us being blessed. That keeps us in his favor. I love this. And Isaiah 61:10 says, "The Lord makes me very happy." Oh, yeah, I hope he makes you very happy. "All that I am rejoices in my God. He has covered me with clothes of salvation and wrapped me with a coat of goodness. Like a bridegroom dressed for his wedding, like a bride dressed in jewels." I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I remember one of the greatest days of my life was when I got married. You know, like, it was just an amazing time, like nerves, and it went by so fast and all these things, but it was an epic day, you know, and I remember the joy that was in my heart, right? You're just like, wow, I can't believe that I'm actually going to marry my best friend. I can't believe that this day has come. And it's saying like, man, that's the same feeling we should have every day when we think about how Jesus Christ came and that this day happened, right? Like, I mean, when we first came to the Lord, I bet you felt just light on your toes. I always describe it as feeling as light as a feather, like just burdens and the sorrow, and just so many things were lifted off my shoulders that I was able to walk out of that building, that church, just floating, you know, just so excited about who Christ was and the start of my new life. I mean, it still took a whole lot of pruning and a whole lot of like trouble, I guess you'd say, that I got myself in, you know, the struggle, and you know, but you know, ultimately the Lord just continued to have patience and continued to work on me. But I mean, like that initial rejoicing, that time that you just are just so excited about what happened that you just got to go tell the next person you see. I mean, we're hoping that that's what feeling you always get. I mean, you know, like I was laughing in that verse, but I mean, the fact that we have God's favor, the fact that He is in us, the fact that He is our Lord, we should be very happy and we should rejoice. That's why in Philippians 4:4 it says, rejoice in the Lord always. And then, I mean, it even says, again, I tell you, rejoice always. He says it twice, Paul does, because, I mean, why would we not? Why would we have any other type of posture? Our posture should always be one of rejoicing, because, I mean, we are now alive. And in the worst day, as a believer, is better than the best day as a non-believer. And I truly believe that with all my heart. In 61:11 says, for as the soil makes the young plant come up and a garden causes the seeds to grow, so the sovereign Lord will make righteousness and praise spring up before all nations. So as we rejoice and as we become just doers of the word, not just hearers, and as the world sees who we belong to by the attitude of our hearts and by the way we present ourselves in our everyday lives, we will start to hunger for what is righteous. I mean, it says in Matthew 5:6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be satisfied. It's another way to say we will hunger for what is the right thing to do, and the right thing to do is what God wants us to do, right? So like, we will be like hungering and thirsting for the life that God wants us to live. We want to be able to live about our own business, but we always want to be about the business of the Lord, because I mean, we wouldn't be able to go without it. We'll be hungering for it. We'll be thirsting for it, right? Like, it's one of those things we can't do without. We can't do without food, and we can't do without water. And it's saying that same way you can't do without food and water, we will not be able to do without righteousness or doing what's right. We will not be able to go without, you know, the Lord seeing us glorify Him, because we would just want to, because we know that He has given us such favor that I can't imagine not doing it, right? Getting towards the end right here, we just read through the whole chapter 61 of Isaiah. There might be a couple of you guys out there that maybe you've never experienced this favor. You don't know what this favor is. You never made that choice to come to the Lord. And right here in 2 Corinthians, Paul runs to the Corinthian church and he says about the Lord, for he says, in the time of my favor, I heard you, and in the day of salvation, I helped you. I tell you, now is the time of God's favor, and now is the day of salvation. Don't wait anymore, because today is the day that, you know, you could come to the Lord. the Lord has been just waiting for you to make that decision. If you're even considering giving your life over to the Lord, that's not because of what I've said, but it's because of what the Holy Spirit has tugged and put into your heart. And I pray that you answer that tugging, and that you're willing to step out of the boat and into the water and just follow Christ, because you will not regret it. And I was in closing, I saw this this quote, and I just wanted to share it with all of you. It says, never forget that you are one of a kind. Never forget that if there weren't any need for you and all your uniqueness to be on this earth, you wouldn't be here in the first place. And never forget, no matter how overwhelming life's challenges and problems seem to be, that one person can make a difference in the world. In fact, it is always because of one person that all changes that matter in the world come about. So be that one person. Buckminster Fuller. So you guys could all stand. I mean, I know you guys are probably at home, so you probably won't stand, but if you guys want to just hear this prayer. I want to pray for all of you guys. I want to pray for the fact that you may just have needed to hear this, so that way you could be reminded of the fact that God's favor is everywhere in your life, and he's constantly taking care of you and making sure that you have favor. You know, maybe I want to pray for those who have never come to Christ and you want to get in on this favor. And you want to get in on this love that sounds amazing, because it is. It's amazing. It's amazing grace that he shows us. I want to pray for all, for both groups. If you guys could close your eyes, you guys could just open your hearts. Lord Jesus, Father of heaven and earth, we are so blessed for the fact that you loved us first, so now we love you. Lord, it says here in Psalm 23:6 that surely your goodness and love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Lord, thank you for letting us into your house. Thank you for allowing us to be forgiven, for paying our debt. Lord, let us every day, always and all the time, come to you when we need you, and not be just angry about, not be angry about what's going on in our lives right now. For even if it's hard or tough, we know that you're still with us and you'll get us through it. For you have made us overcomers, Lord. For you've overcame this world and we'll overcome it too. So Lord, I just pray a special blessing for anyone in earshot of this message. And I just pray that you just give them comfort, give them joy, fill their hearts with just this overpowering willingness to just go and be a light to this world. Lord, we love you. Thank you. We pray this all in your name, Jesus. And we all said, amen. Thank you again. I hope next time I get to see you in person. But for now, this will do. So I love you. God bless. See you soon.
Let us confess our faith with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He preached to the dead. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
All right, as we prepare for communion, let's sing a medley about love, starting with "How Marvelous, How Wonderful Is My Savior's Love for Me." I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall end.
In the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he met with his disciples in the upper room for the Passover dinner. While they were sitting there, he took the bread and he broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body which is given for you. After they finished eating, he took the cup. He blessed it and said, "This is my blood which is shed for you. Drink all of it in remembrance of me." And now let us say the prayer that Jesus gave us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
All right, let's finish the service with "Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing."
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.